What's going on, guys? Scar coming at you with another Magic the Gathering video. So M21's out. We all know all the cards that have come out. We've kind of seen some of the decks that have come out into the meta. With it being a new month and the start of a new season, I figured I'd drop the top of the meta list for the beginning of July. I for reference, I use Aetherhub. They run it through their MTG assistant tool, and they kind of figure out what the top list of the meta is currently being played in the arena based on their app. So overall, this is that data from there. I mean, if you have another source of data from somewhere else, let me know in the comments below. I can then use this and kind of like reference and kind of find the averages of what the top meta is. But this is like a top eight. So overall, we'll kind of look at the meta for best of one, kind of see where everything's working out right now. I will say, looking at it as I was kind of adding it into the arena, I don't have all the cards. So when you look at the decks, the decks may be incomplete, but these are all for best of one, and it is very aggressive. All the card decks that are out there are super aggressive. So enough of that said, guys, let's dive into the decks. Let's break it all down. If you like the video, guys, hit the like button. If you want to post more videos, hit the subscribe button, but let's dive into the decks and kind of see how the meta is shaping up. All right, so starting it off, we are going into mono red. This one is the cavalcade version of mono red. This is the number eight slot. This is going to be like a top eight, I guess. I don't really know, but it's out of eight decks that they listed. So we're going to go with those eight decks just because they listed them. We're going to go with them and say that these are the eight decks. So it is cavalcade. Nothing really has super changed on cavalcade. A few cards here or there, but I guess this is the one that's performed very, very well, the one they ran the list of the top eight. So what it is it's pretty much, you know, Grim Initiate for the 1/1 Scorch Spitter, because you know he's a 1/1 with the additional damage. Cavalcade of Calamity, because this is how the deck works. Makes your 1/1s just do one more damage on top of their normal damage. Chandra's Pyreling, which is a new card from M21. If you don't know what this is, whenever a source you control deals non-combat damage to an opponent, it gets +1/+0 and gains double strike. So you have this in Cavalcade, you're already gonna get something that's gonna be pretty beefy with double strike, which is definitely very good. I know it doesn't have a trample, but it gives it double strike, and if your opponent doesn't block it, it could get very dangerous very, very quickly. So Chandra's Pyreling, Forbidden Friendship is another new addition I think I've seen to the Cavalcade deck, but just because it creates 2/1s, it gives you additional pings for that Cavalcade. Then we got Thunder King Awakener, which is a card from M20. Whenever it attacks, choose target elemental creature card in your graveyard with toughness less than Thunder King Awakener's toughness and return that card to the battlefield. Tap and attack and sacrifice at the beginning of the next end step. So what this does is if like your Scorch Spitter gets up in the graveyard, you can get the Scorch Spitter back. Pyreling is actually... Pyreling unfortunately is not affected, but if we have any other elementals in the deck, but really Scorch Spitter just comes back out with it, is the best thing that we can hit. So Thunderkin Awakener is the one card there. Then of course it's a red deck, so you are going to play Annex. The thing is, actually I didn't know this, I completely didn't realize that you can legend rule Annex. If you play Annex and then another Annex, and then actually counts both of their devotion to red at the same time, so they both go up to four, and when you choose one, when you sacrifice it, you get the triggers of the additional satyr tokens for each of them for the four power. So then you get 4/1/1 satyrs. So that's actually a cool little trick that I noticed, I guess something that someone picked up on that was a thing. So that's definitely something to look out for if you decide to play a cavalcade deck, is that you can double Annex and get double the tokens and actually get hit the four toughness and actually just legend roll it to get the additional tokens. So that's actually a cool play. Then Bonecrusher Giant, just because Bonecrusher Giant is Bonecrusher Giant, it's a good burn card, as well as a 4/3 body, just you know, in case you get a little bit bigger. Chandra's Alkylate, just because you know, creates 1/1 elemental tokens, so more cavalcade triggers. Chandra's Spitfire, because it just from the cavalcade, it's another card that gets pumped up every time you do whenever source of deals damage to an opponent, gets +3/+0 in a turn. It has flying, so if your opponent doesn't play a lot of flying, it just flies right over and hits your opponent in the face. Even with one and like three other creatures plus this, you're gonna hit for really big, and your opponent would probably just scoop right then and there if they can't block it and deal with it. Torbrand's another thing, so it makes our cavalcades just do that two additional damage every time they trigger, as well as makes all our red creatures also do additional two, so it just kind of ends the game a little bit quicker. Emberclay, because why not, let's finish off the game. Dwarven Mind, just to get a 1/1 out of a land. But we only play one of, because you don't want to have a tap land in a red deck, because you just want to be aggressive every single turn and do damage to your opponent's face. And 21 mounts to wrap it up. But overall, the deck is pretty straightforward. Nothing, like I said, has really changed much from the Cavalcade decks that have been out. Pyreland's really only new addition. You can tweak this how you want. If there's things that you want to play that are also one ones that you think are better, you can tweak them, and I'm sure you can probably find a spot. I mean, you could always get rid of Thunder King Awakeners and maybe play the 1/1 haste goblin that you can sacrifice and gives another creature haste. which could give like your Pyreling or your Chandra Spitfire haste, maybe in a turn where you, if you think you can swing in, trigger it, you can do the damage to win the game. It's definitely a card that you can definitely add, and it's cheaper than playing at the Nuke and Awakener if you don't want to spend the wild cards to actually play it. So then moving on to the next deck. All right, so the next deck is a Yorion deck. It's Orzhov. It is a black-white deck. It's pretty much what the goal here is. You want to flicker in a lot of the things on the battlefield over and over again. So Yorion flickers anything that you own other than lands back off the battlefield, back onto the battlefield. So that's one thing. You got Charming Prince is another thing to also flicker things. You can also gain some life if you're in a pinch where you need to gain some life. You want to look at the top two cards of your library. That's another thing. You can scry to kind of set up your turns. So Charming Prince is another card that's in the deck. Yorion Sky Command Nomad is your companion. So you're playing 80 cards in this deck. It's a flyer. It's 4/5. And like I said, it flickers things in and out of the battlefield. Then the way this deck is kind of working out, it kind of is a hand hate deck as well as a board control deck. So you're going to play Burglar Rats, which makes your opponent each discard a card. Whenever it enters the battlefield, Yorox Fenlicker, which makes an exile card from their hand. And also you can use it as a pump, but it's really there just to, you know, give a little bit of hand hate to make them make tough choices. Especially if, you know, you're on the play. Definitely puts your opponent in tough choices if they have to get rid of something that maybe they want to play in the later game. Cry of the Canarium, because it really just... And it really eliminates a lot of your more aggressive, like smaller decks that play small drops like 1/1s and 2/2s and stuff like that. And they also get exiled instead of dying, so that's that. Treacherous Blessing, which gets us aggressive to dig into the deck to actually get two cards we may want to refill our hand. And every time we play a spell, we're going to lose one life. Then you get Kaya to actually exile two target cards in a single graveyard. We gain two life if at least one creature card was exiled this way. We can exile target non-land permanent with a converted mana cost one or less. We can get rid of like an oven or something like that with it. And if we get to it, we can -5 and it deals damage to target player equal to the number player owns in their exile, and we gain that much life. So using like Fenlurker plus this, we can actually gain a decent amount of life and make our opponent lose that much life. So definitely pretty decent if we get to the five. It's not too expensive for a 3-cost planeswalker, but Kaya. Then we got Oath of Kaya because, you know, it's another good card. It protects our planeswalkers. It deals 3 damage to any target, as well as we gain 3 life. And then whenever our opponent attacks with one or more creatures towards one of our planeswalkers, it deals 2 damage to that player and we gain 2 life. So it's another good way to, they have to kind of, if they want to really take damage to attack our planeswalkers kind of thing, especially in the late game, they may not want to attack into planeswalkers, which kind of sets us up to maybe win the game. But Oath of Kaya is definitely good to kind of spot removal and or deal damage to someone's face. Then we got Elspeth, Sun's Nemesis, just a good way to get some creatures on the battlefield, get some pump up any of our threats on the battlefield, and or -3, we can -5/-3 and gain 5 life. And then we can escape it from the graveyard for 6. So just a good way to just kind of get some board presence, gain some life, or, you know, pump something up on the battlefield that's, you know, just to give that little bit more oomph. Doom Foretold is another card here. So with us playing a lot of very hand hate slash maybe board hate, Doom Foretold kind of makes our opponent sacrifice target non-land, non-token permanent. If that player can't, they discard a card and they lose 2 life. You draw a card, you gain 2 life, and we get a 2/2 White Knight token on the battlefield Vigilance, and then we sacrifice Doom Foretold. So just a good way to kind of like keeping things off the battlefield. If they can't get a very big board, this is actually going to just prevent them from really playing anything on the battlefield. Especially with a small hand, they won't be able to play very wide. And then we are able to take advantage of the Doom Foretold. Then you got Kaya's Wrath to kind of wipe the board. We gain life equal to the number of creatures that died, that were destroyed this way. So Kaya's Wrath is a board wipe. We got Karn to go to our sideboard to get anything that maybe we need. Depend on the matchup. So Karn's there for that. It prevents any of the activated abilities of our artifacts. Our opponent's control, so they can't use like oven and stuff like that, so that's definitely a thing. Elspeth Conqueror's Death, just because it's so strong, might as well have things to exile big things, make our opponent's things cost more, their non-creature spells cost more, and then get in planeswalkers or creatures back from our graveyard to with a +1/+1 or loyalty counter, especially depending on the situation, like a Yorion or even getting back like a Kaya or something like that is definitely good too. And then Yorion Sky Nomad, you know, we play copies in the deck, so we draw them also in the later game. We can flicker things in and out, keep on triggering things as, and it's just a good thing just in case something happens to our companion one, or we don't actually want to spend the mana to bring it into our hand. We draw it and then play this one instead. And then we play a whole bunch of lands to kind of finish out the deck. So you got Castle Ardenvale for some tokens, 7 Plains, 3 Castle Lochthwain, 9 Swamps, God of the Shrines, Temple of Silence, Savoy Triumph, Adath of Triumph, and Fable Passages to kind of filter mana. And then here is our wish board, depending on what you're looking for. So Crypt to get rid of someone's graveyard if they're playing like a graveyard-centric deck. Grafter's Cage to prevent them from playing things. from their graveyard, and they can't cast creature cards, and libraries can't have things come into the battlefield. So your opponent plays a deck that like makes you go through your library and puts the card on the battlefield. That doesn't happen. Shadow Spear for some life gain, Soul Lantern to kind of also exile each opponent's graveyard, and we can draw a card if we really want to. Glass Cast to just get rid of that one small little pesky thing on the battlefield. Sorcerer's Spygraphs to kind of lock down our opponent and make the activate abilities of that thing not go off. Spark Hunt the Manticore, just because, you know, it has protection for planeswalkers, deals one damage to target planeswalker, it can gain indestructible at the end of turn, and it's a 3-4 for 3. Solem, just for giggles. Pull a Citadel, you know, just to kind of like dig through our deck. A lot of our stuff is fairly cheap, so we can kind of dig through it and kind of gain life, and, you know, if we have a lot of permanents, we can also sacrifice and then make our opponent lose 10 life. Statue for just, you know, a periodic end of turn thing, as well as make our opponent's things more expensive. Meteor Golems just, you know, kind of prevent or, you know, destroy something, and Stone Coil Serpent as well if we want to get a little bit more aggressive if they play a lot of multicolor. But overall, that's our wish board for the most part for this deck. It's pretty straightforward. It seems like an interesting deck. It seems like it's more built for that best of one matchup, just because it kind of plays a little bit of like a sideboard and a main deck as a matchup. You know, it kind of plays like what a best of three is, a little bit here, a little bit there, depending on matchup. So it has a little bit of everything for everything. So overall, it looks like a fun deck, and it is like the number 7 overall top meta deck currently in the format. All right, so next up is a deck that I think we may already know. This is the Boggles deck, or mono white enchantments. So pretty much it's that straightforward deck that we play a whole bunch of small things. We put enchantments on them, play all that glitters and things like that, that kind of just kind of want to get into our opponent and deal damage to them. So we play lowers to get things back from our graveyard that costs 2 or less. We play all seas to protect anything that may has enchantments on it. Glaring Aegis to kind of give things more toughness as well as defense, our power as well as defense. And it can kind of target to tap something down if we want to swing in for damage. God's Willing to give something protection of a particular color to end a turn. We get a scry. Healer's Talk to fly over, gain some life. Kometra's Blessing to kind of give something +2 until end of turn. And we can also give that thing Hexproof for Indestructible in case our opponent tries to target it with a spell. Sentinel's Eyes to give it Vigilance, a +1/+1. Solid Footing to also give it +1/+1. And as long as the creature has Vigilance, it actually deals damage equal to its toughness instead of its power. All that glitters because if we have all these enchantments on it, it pretty much gets +1/+1 for each one of those enchantments. So it gets really, really big. Hushbringer to kind of prevent things from triggering their and coming to play or death abilities. Sentinel's Mark, another thing that gives it vigilance, as well as we cast it in our main phase. Enchanted creature gains lifelink at the end of turn, so it gives some lifelink. And Stone Coil Serpent, which, to be honest, I don't know why this list runs Stone Coil. I guess maybe if you draw a lot of lands, you can tap big X and then play a Stone Coil and it has protection from multicolor, but it doesn't run Ginger Brutes, which is another card that you can run as well if you don't have Stone Coils, which are just things that you can tap mana to actually make them unblockable unless the creatures have haste. And it's a little 1/1 gingerbread token card thing. So I guess this one just gets a little more aggressive once, you know, maybe if you get to the later game, you play a giant Stone Coil, so that's cool. And then Castle Ardenvale and 20 Planes. Just a pretty much overall solid deck. It's a fun deck. Especially when you get a lot of things, you just make like one big creature and then swing in, do a lot of damage. But overall, it's a deck that we've seen before. I actually made a video on this before, so definitely want to check that out. I'll probably leave a card somewhere along this way if you want to see that deck. All right, so the next up is Mardu Knights. This is another deck that's been around. I don't think really gained anything too much from M21, so it's pretty much a list that you may have seen. It's just a very aggressive deck. It's a tribal deck that runs all knights. Plays lowers to get those knights back from our graveyard back onto the battlefield. Fight is one to kind of give things +1/+1 indestructible. Venerable Knight is another good card because it gives +1/+1 counter target knight we control. Broadmere Knight to kind of, you know, have a death touch creature, as well as if we want to use it in a later game, we can always draw a card and lose a life. Knight of Evolution, just because it's a very strong one drop knight, and we can tap 3, give +3/+3, and if our opponent takes 4 more life, or they lose four more life, they get a +1/+1 counter until, you know, so on and so forth. Fervent Champion, you know what this does, it's an all mono reds, it's super annoying, super aggressive. +1/+0 until end of turn. So definitely a card that's annoying, but definitely a good card for this deck. Worthy Knight, whenever you cast a knight spell, create a 1/1 human token creature, so it makes us go wide. Blacklands Paragon, it's a flash knight that allows us to give something death touch and lifelink down the turn. We can give it to itself if we want to kind of just, you know, block something and get just, you know, kill it and gain some life in the process. Spin Sword Master, because we actually make our opponent lose life and gain life equal to the number of knights we control, as well as it's a 2/1 lifelinker. Dire Tactics, because it's actually very strong spot removal in this deck, just because majority of the knights are all humans, minus like the Knight of the Ebon Legion, but most of the other knights are all humans. Storm Crusader, just because it's another human knight as well. It allows us to draw a little bit deeper at the point of taking some life loss due to it, but also has menace, so we can swing in it and our opponent would have to block with two creatures. And then Inspiring Veteran, which gives all our knights +1/+1. And then it's a mixture of a bunch of lands, so 2 plains, 4 swamps, 4 godless shrines, 4 blood crypts, 4 sacred foundries, and 4 tournament grounds, which is like the tricolor knight mana, which is actually very solid, especially for this deck. And the deck's overall cheap because we play Loris as our companion. But it's actually a pretty solid deck that is decently aggressive in a best of one meta. So if you get a good hand, you can definitely go off even without a lot of lands. So definitely a good deck overall. And that's probably why a lot of people play it. So the next deck up is actually a deck. It's pretty much just a Simic ramp deck that's been around. It maybe splashes in a couple of the new cards. But overall, the deck here is to get up to high, a lot of mana very, very quickly to drop your Nissa, drop your Ugin. You know, just play a lot of big things on earlier turns than you normally would be able to play them. So we start off with 4 Abriel Grazers, just because it enters the battlefield, we reveal a land card from our hand to play tap, so kind of ramp up for a turn 1 cost. Scavenging Juice is actually a new card for M21, which allows us to target card in a graveyard and exile target card from graveyard. If it was a creature card, you get a +1/+1 counter, it gains 1 life, we gain 1 life, and it gets bigger. So definitely a good card to not be underestimated. It's a good thing to get rid of Uros and things like that could return, pesky cats that could return from the graveyards, you know, if you know, from the whatchamacallit decks, the sacrifice decks. So definitely a good card, definitely something that can get out of hand very quickly if one doesn't deal with it. Grow Spiral, another ramp card, 2 mana to draw a card, and then on top of it you can put a land card from our hand onto the battlefield to get additional land out onto it on turn 2, which is really crazy. Cultivate, it's a 3 cost, which allows us to search for library for 2 basic land cards, reveal those cards, put one onto the battlefield tap, the other one into our hands, so just another card to ramp up. Uro, you know what he does, he comes into the battlefield, he sacrifices, unless he's been escaped, we gain 3 life, we draw a card, and then we can put a land card from our hand onto the battlefield, just in general, and then we can do the same thing when he actually comes and escapes, and every time he attacks, he does the same thing. So, definitely a good card to ramp up even quicker. Teferi the Time Master, he's the new Planeswalker that came out in M21, I did a video with Azorius Control playing him. He's allowed to use his abilities on your turn as well as your opponent's turn, so we can actually tick up a lot quicker. You can +1 to draw a card, discard a card, -3 to phase a creature out, which that means there's it doesn't exist on the battlefield, and then comes back onto the battlefield on its controller's next turn. And then if we get there, we can -10 and take 2 extra turns after this one. But majority it's here for the card draw and then phasing out things that we don't want to deal with at a time or if we don't want to answer for. Soul of Simulacrum is another card. It's a 2/2 for 4. But the good thing about this one is we can search our land for a library for a land card, put on the battlefield tapped, and then on top of it, whenever it dies, we get to draw a card. So it's a pretty solid card for 2/2, as well as with Ugin. If we use the -X, it doesn't actually get sacrificed because it has no color. So it's actually a good creature to have on the battlefield to not get killed off from an Ugin. Then we got Nissa, who shakes the world. 5 cost, very annoying planeswalker, which makes all our green mana attack for additional green. And then we get to put +1, put 1/1 counters on up to target 1 non-creature land we control. Untap it, becomes a 0/0 elemental creature with vigilance and haste and still land. So our lands become creatures, we can swing in with them, and then whenever we tap any of our green mana, we just produce additional green mana. And then we can -8 if we get there, and we can make all our lands indestructible, and then search our library for any number of forest cards, put them on the battlefield tapped, and then shuffle our library. So we can just move all the forests out of our library if we get there, but it's +1 is very, very strong, and the ability to kind of make our mana produce additional mana is always good. And then Big Daddy Ugin, the new dragon, the new planeswalker from M21, we can +2 and deal 3 damage to any target, which even means the opponent's face and or planeswalkers. We can -X each permanent with a converted mana cost X or less, that's one or more colors, exiles, and then if we get to -10, we can -10, gain 7 life, draw 7 cards, then put up the 7 permanent cards from our hand onto the battlefield. Definitely a pretty crazy planeswalker, and he's an 8 cost and he's already at 7, so 2 turns after he's played he can definitely already get to his ultimate. And then because we have a lot of lands and a lot of ramp, Hydroid Crisis, just because, you know, we can get a big Hydroid out on the battlefield as well as draw, gain X life, draw half of X cards, and then round down each time, and then it enters the battlefield with X +1/+1 counters on it. So definitely get a big Hydroid in the late game if we want to finish off our opponent. 7 Islands, 9 Forests, 4 Breeding Pools, 4 Temples, and 4 Keetra's Triomes. But overall, it's a pretty solid deck. If you get a lot of ramp up and have an Ugin, you can play turn 5 Ugin, which and a lot of times we'll just kind of set your opponent back to the beginning and you may be able to get away with a victory very early. All right, so next we're going to Rakdos. This is kind of getting to that territory of it's the sacrifice deck. So get already out there. It's a sacrifice deck. It plays Gigantha as the planeswalker just because none of our cards in our library have more than one of the same symbol. So that's the only thing. And it's a 5/5 for five, and we can bring it back into our hand on turn three if we don't have a play. A Cauldron Familiar, we run that because it's a cat that you sacrifice, ping a life, sacrifice food, bring it back to the battlefield, so on and so forth. Just repeat the process, doing one damage, gaining one life. Gutter Bones, just for a little bit early turn aggressiveness. We can also tap two, return it from our graveyard to our hand, activate this only during a turn and only if opponent lost life this turn. So with the Cauldron Familiar, the Gutter Bones can always recycle in and out. Serrated Scorpion, this is another solid drop that came out of Ikoria. Whenever it dies, it does 2 damage to each opponent. You gain 2 life, so a good way to gain some life. Village Rites is actually a new card that's added to the deck. It just gives us an additional way to sacrifice things. And as well, we can sacrifice something and gain and draw 2 cards. So we can even claim the Firstborn, one of our opponent's things, sacrifice it, and we draw 2 cards with their card. So claims the Firstborn, gain control, target creature with commitment cost 3 or less. Untap that creature, it gains haste. So we kind of take something of theirs, like becomes ours. We can use it to sacrifice. To a priest, to a village rites, to a witch's oven. So just additional ways to kind of, you know, abuse our opponent's creatures on them, you know, and use them against them. Witch's oven to make our Cauldron Familiar, and then just use it in reactionary in case our opponent decides to target anything. Priest of the Forgotten Gods, because it's such a good card for 2, sacrifice 2 other creatures. Each player loses 2 life, sacrifice a creature, and then we gain 2 mana and draw a card. So by us losing, we gain a lot from that. And then Call to the Death Dweller allows us to return stuff from our graveyard with the commitment cost 3 or less. Put Death Touch kind of on either of them, and Menace kind of on either of them. So we can put that on something we want to be aggressive with, like a Gutter Bones or even Mayhem Devil. Mayhem Devil is actually pretty interesting for this because you can actually put a Death Touch counter on it, and every time it deals its little ping, it'll just ping off whatever it is with Death Touch, especially creatures. And no matter what their toughness is, they'll end up dying in the process. Midnight Reaper, another good card because it allows us to draw deeper into the deck. But we do take damage in the process, but if we can get a good rotation of things, it's not the biggest of deals, and we get to draw a lot of cards, especially with the Cauldron Familiar combo kind of thing going off. It's a good way for us to kind of negate that damage. Then we got Woe Strider, just another way to sacrifice things. We get a 0/1 white goat token on the battlefield, and when we sacrifice something, we can scry one, and we can escape it in case it gets killed and or removed from the game, or we just discard it and put it in the graveyard in some sort of way. So another good thing to get additional, ways to dig into our deck to find what we're looking for. Mayhem Devil is the card that gets annoying. So when we start sacrificing all this stuff, Mayhem Devil actually then deals damage to any target. So it pings things for 1. So definitely something that gets annoying, especially if it has a Death Touch counter, because then it starts just, you know, pew, pew, pewing things away. And they can't really do anything about it because Death Touch just kills it instantly. Then on top of that, the land's base is pretty straightforward. Castle, Locked Wains for some card draw, maybe for the hands getting a little thin. 6 Swamps, 2 Mountains, 4 Bloodcrypts, 4 Temple of Malice, and 4 Pale Passages. Overall, this is just your typical Rakdos deck. Nothing really changed other than adding village rites. But overall, it's pretty straightforward. Play Cauldron Familiar, annoy your opponent by doing sacrifice things, and they'll probably skip at some point. All right, so just like the first deck, this is just pretty much the same deck, but we lose a color and we're just playing Mardu, or we gain a color. I don't really know. So it's technically a 3-color deck, even though we don't really play 3 colors. It's another Rakdos deck, but it's pretty much the same thing as the other one. It's Cauldron Familiars to kind of cycle these in and out, doing damage. Serrated Scorpion, same thing, clean the Firstborn, take our opponent's things, which is oven to kind of, you know, cycle our Cauldron Familiar, or just sacrifice things that we may take for the claim the Firstborn. Priest of the Forgotten Gods is to make our opponent sacrifice things. Dreadhorde Butcher to kind of get some more aggressive aggro against our opponent. Call the Death Dweller to get anything that's mana cost 3 or less back to the battlefield that may have gone there. So just kind of getting anything back that, you know, we want to get back on the battlefield to kind of just repeat processes. Midnight Reaper to draw cards and we lose a life. Loris, another good way to get back our small drops. We play it in the deck instead of as a companion, so we can play our bigger things, and allows us to kind of just play our smaller things back once a turn. Mayhem Devil for the pinging, and then Castle Lockthwain's, 6 Swamps, 6 Mountains, 4 Bloodcrypts, 2 Temple of Malice, and 1 Fatal Passage. I don't really want to go into too much detail because it's pretty much the same detail as the last deck, but it's another good solid deck that's just super annoying. It's just a good way. It's a very strong deck, very aggressive deck, and kind of annoys your opponent if they don't deal with any of these things. All right, now coming on to the last deck. This is another mono red deck. This is the more aggressive, the bigger mono red deck, or the mid-range mono red deck, but overall it's the same as the other one. We play Fervent Champion to get be very aggressive, hit our opponent in the face on turn one, Scorch Pitter for the same thing. It's a very aggressive card. It deals one damage regardless of it actually hitting the opponent or not. Shock for some spot removal, Tinstry Dodger to kind of get by our opponent if they have something big and we just want to get by, like a wall or something. Well, not a wall, but something else that's big. It's just some unblockable damage. Rimrock Knight for the pump, as well as we can play it as a 3-1 body. Robber of the Witch, just because it's a good card, especially if our opponent's playing something slow, we can definitely take advantage of taking their things, as well as Reach and Haste, so it's another solid 2-drop. Renewing Steenkin, just because it's the way we make a lot of mana. On top of playing mana, we can play a lot. If we're playing spells on curve properly, we can definitely get to the counters to get removed to make mana to then play like an Embercleave and just, you know, wipe our opponent's face, you know, very, very quickly. Annex, just because it's another solid card. It gets bigger every time we play anything with a red Devotion. Stormcrusher Giant for the stomp, as well as the 4-3 body. Life to Stage to dig a little bit deeper into our deck. It's just a good way to kind of keep on filling our hand up as we kind of get lower. Torbrand to just do additional damage to our opponent if they, you know, with our red things. Embercleave for us to just trample over and smash our opponent in the face with a giant annex or something like that. Castle Unbreath just to make everything bigger if we swing in for an attack. And 18 Mountains. I could go all on about how mono red works, but it's just pretty straightforward. Just play a bunch of things, hit our opponent as quickly as possible by turn 4 or turn 5, get in range of an Embercleave finish, and game's over. But overall, that is the list of the top meta decks currently going on in the best of one. I'm not saying these are decks you're definitely going to face as you play, but these are the decks that are more than likely, majority of the meta is playing. I'm going to say if you're playing the ranked ladder, you probably see more of this. But overall, this is just to give you an idea. These are some things that you may want to actually play yourself. I'll leave all the deck lists in the comments below for you to actually take a look at. Actually, I'll probably link you to the article that I actually pulled these from on AetherHub that kind of just broke it down and put everything in one general area instead of linking a bunch of different best of one decks. I can just link you to the article where all these deck lists can be found. If you guys have any comments, leave a comment down below. What do you think about the meta? Like I said, the best of three meta is very aggressive because, you know, you're not going to a sideboard to kind of fix anything. So everything's just trying to hit your opponent as quickly as possible and get the game over with and moving on to the next one. But guys, if you liked the video, hit that like button. If you want to know I post more videos, hit the subscribe button, and I will catch you in the next video.